The body weight is my first choice because this is the most misused and that's why it's often misunderstood. So what is weight and how does it work in skiing? If I jump off the first floor, I will fall because the earth attracts me. When I'm in the air, I experience gravity as an acceleration toward the ground, but I don't feel my weight. But when I'm on the ground, I cannot fall because the ground is under me. Underground, I experience gravity as a force by which the earth pushes my body mass. This is weight. On earth, gravity is constant. I can go anywhere and do anything. Gravity affects me and always acts vertically toward the center of the earth. There is no stronger or weaker gravity, whether horizontal or slanted. A Formula One driver experiences 4-5 Gs in a turn or when braking, and a ski racer 2-3 Gs in a turn. Some people believe that the G-force is a force created by gravity, but it's not true. 1 G is a measurement created by an acceleration equal to gravity. This load is due to the acceleration or deceleration of the turn or the brakes, so it means that they must withstand the load 2-5 times greater than that of gravity. Stationary skiers affect their skis with their weight. However, when a moving skier's body flies or moves relatively independently over the skis won't experience much pressure due to the skier's weight. The physics of a stationary skier is very different from that of a moving one. Practically, we all make the mistake of explaining skiing while standing. When standing still, without kinetic energy from the turn, our weight provides the load. But once we start skiing, the physics we felt while standing still becomes invalid. Gravity and weight acts vertically, but the turn mainly laterally. So it's not that the forces acting in the turn replace gravity, but rather that they work together in different directions and functions. If the skier's speed runs out at the end of the turn, they lie down on the snow due to gravity, but they can stay standing until they preserve enough speed. Gravity affects every body part individually, not just center of the gravity or the entire body as a single object. The phone in your pocket is like a part of your body, but if your pocket is open, it will fall separately. The zipper ensures a connection to your body. It's the same thing with backpacks. Your ski pole, arms, head or upper body can move independently of your lower parts when you release muscle tension, much like opening a zipper or a strap. For example, banking happens due to the weaker connection between the upper and the lower body. As in many other sports, we stand two legs while skiing. If someone weighs 80 kg, each leg can carry 40 kilos, which is the maximum weight we can transfer when standing on one leg. It may seem that moving the upper body to the side may also transfer body weight. Checking it on the scale shows that the trunk side bending alone doesn't significantly affect the body weight distribution. The reason is that to stay balanced, your center of gravity must be over the support. So if you move your torso to the side, you must move the same amount to the opposite side, otherwise you will fall. To measure more weight on one leg, you must move your center of body over this leg, and you will balance on one leg. So, bending only the upper body to the side doesn't really affect the body weight distribution, nor does it change the pressure on the skis. Another question is, why would we transfer the weight onto one ski? In the case of a snowplow turn, weak snow contact is not a common problem. The grip ensured by half of the body weight is more than enough to turn on an easy slope at a slower speed. Moreover, it can be too much, making it difficult to steer the ski at a slow speed. So beginners sometimes need to free up the ski first to steer it instead of pressing it down. So the question is, does it make any sense to transfer the weight between the legs? And if so, to which leg? The outside or inside leg? The phrase unweighting means reducing the downforce on the skis. With the old skis like this here, Reducing the downforce was necessary for an everyday skier to initiate a turn, because the 40-50 meter radius was too long to start a turn without twisting the ski. For the same reason, skiers used to brake at the end of the turn. Nowadays, starting a turn without twisting or rotating the skis isn't a problem for a carving ski, so usually we don't need any extra movement to unweight the skis. Reducing the downforce is different for a stationary and a moving skier. A moving skier can use the kinetic energy from different momentum directions of various body parts. Without kinetic energy from the turn, a slow-moving or a stationary skier can temporarily change the downforce by moving the body up and down. In the case of a so-called up-unweighting, the downforce decreases near the top point of the movement and then when the body accelerates down during the falling phase. The downside is that lifting your body will push the ski down, even if you don't want to. So the first activity of an up-unweighting is an extra pressure with an extra movement. That's why it can mix up the ideal load progression of a turn. There was a lot of information about the weight, and in the next video we're gonna speak about the pressure. Stay with us and see you soon in the next video.